Buonasera a tutti. Bruchim abayim. Bimyuchad lechol mi shehigia lepo meharetz. A very cordial welcome to all of you here this evening at the Pontifical Gregorian University for the 14th Brenningmeier-Wehrhahn lecture delivered by Professor Mark Hirschman, bearing the title Song, Speech and Silence: Jewish and Christian Education in Late Antiquity. I'm Father Philip Gabriel Rentsches, director of the Cardinal Beer Center of Judaic Studies at this university, which in partnership with the Center for the Study of Christianity at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem organizes tonight's event. At this point, I would like to give the floor to Father François-Xavier Dumortier, Rettore Magnifico of this Pontifical University.
Your Excellence, dear Mrs. Brenningmeier, dear Professor Mark Hirschman, dear friends. The Brenningmeier-Wehrhahn lecture is always one of the most significant events in our academic life at the Pontifical Gregorian University, especially at the beginning of the academic year. And I am really delighted to welcome you at the beginning of this 14th lecture. First of all, I would like to greet you, Mrs. Brenningmeier. It's always a great privilege and a real joy to have you with us. On behalf of the Beer Center, of the university, but also of all those who are happy to attend this lecture, I want to thank you deeply for your continuing support and for your generous funding. We know your commitment in favor of the strengthening and of the development of the relationships between Jews and Christians. Your example is really a call to all of us to go forward on the way of mutual understanding, reciprocal trust, and friendship. We have been living in the last 2 months many disturbing events. In the present difficult context, I think that we must deepen our convictions and strengthen our involvement. Hope is never optional. Hope is the way towards the future if we have the real desire of building up a world of peace and justice. But hope, at the same time, requires to commit ourselves to not getting discouraged by obstacles and difficulties, but to opening new creative ways of dialogue. In this context, your presence, Professor Mark Hirschman, is a great honor for us. And as you know, our relationship with the Hebrew University of Jerusalem are quite important for us. Thank you to all of you for your presence, and I wish you a wonderful time listening to Professor Hirschman. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Father Rector, for your presence here tonight with us and your words of welcome. As the Church and also the Gregorian University is preparing for the 50th anniversary commemoration in 2015 of Nostra Aetate, the Second Vatican Council's document that opened a new historical chapter in the relations between the Church and the Jewish people and non-Christian religions, we are at the same time also witnessing the unleashing of violence and war in the Middle East with an intensity unseen for a long time. When at the beginning of this year, 2014, the committee of the Cardinal Beer Center decided to award among the various candidacies Professor Hirschman with his proposal, Song, Speech and Silence in Jewish and Christian Education, to be the follow-up Brenningmeyer-Wehrhahn professor here in Rome, we were certainly aware of smoldering tensions in the name of religion. We did not foresee the extension of the eruption of massive attacks associated with the clash of religions. What may now seem at first sight a luxury moment of relaxation in the academic ivory tower, song, speech, and silence, may at closer inspection turn out to be a necessary and valid meditation on the spiritual and liturgical and educational tools that both the Jewish and the Christian traditions developed precisely to process events that surround us, at different levels affect us, and recurrently overwhelm us. In fact, tonight's biblical buzzwords, silence, speech, and song, could easily be translated into contemporary language, into caring resilience, that stands for silence, responsible protest, that stands for speech, and loving expressions of hope, that stands for song. In this very context, it is my great joy to welcome Dr. Bruria Bitton-Ashkeloni, director of the Center for the Study of Christianity at the Hebrew University, together with her husband, Eland, here tonight. These two centers, the Center for the Study of Christianity in Jerusalem and the Cardinal Bea Center together, form something which is indeed so precious these days, and I dare say, something quite unique. In training and having trained young people, not only to get to know the other tradition, but to learn one from the other, to build a future that is aware of a solid bond that unites Judaism and Christianity. And now it is my great honor to introduce tonight's lecturer, Professor Mark Hirschman, holder of the Mandel Chair of Jewish Education at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. Professor Mark Hirschman is internationally known as researcher on rabbinical thought as it was taught in antiquity and its translation into modern educational systems. His research interests comprise comparative studies of Judaism and Christianity in late antiquity, which obviously qualifies Rome and the Gregorian University a good fit for Professor Hirschman. Professor Hirschman is extremely well published. Let me mention here, insofar these publications are directly related to tonight's lecture, A Rivalry of Genius, Jewish and Christian Biblical Interpretation in Late Antiquity, 1996, Studies in Jewish Education on the Teaching of Rabbinic Literature, 2003, The Stabilization of Rabbinic Culture, 100 CE to 350 CE, Text on Education in Their Late Antique Context, 2009. And I believe his most recent volume, The Gift of the Land and the Fate of the Canaanites in Jewish Thought, 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, to you, Professor Mark Hirschman.
Thank you, Father Rentsch. Thank you also. Magnifico has to be good. Right, so. The Talmud teaches us to begin in two different ways. The first is to thank your host. In Hebrew, that's kvod achsanya, achsanya being a loan word from gzenia. So let me begin with kvod achsanya. The Brenningmeyer-Wehrhahn lecture, I was privileged to meet both sides of the couple back in Jerusalem many years ago, and your work for the Jewish Christian enterprise is very valuable to us, as Bruria constantly reminds me, and we're very appreciative. That's number one. Father Rentsch and Flavia have been such gracious hosts that maybe I'll stay another day. Finally, and this might be the most important, I appreciate, I gave a lot of different topics as possibilities for this lecture. And I was stunned, I was amazed when they chose the education topic. Now, that sounds heretical, but I have to say, of all the books I've published, maybe it's not as good as the others, but the one on education is the least read. And as interesting, as fundamental, important as education is to all three religions, to culture, researching education and writing about it is not popular. I mean, Henri Maru's famous book on education in late in antiquity remains the major work to this very day, some 80 years later, which is amazing. So, my gratitude for allowing me to talk about the topic. It might be at the end of the hour you'll understand why people didn't read the book. I hope not, but... So I've already done the second thing the Talmud teaches us. The second thing the Talmud teaches us, you should always begin with a joke. So we're set and we can start. I'll read part of it. You should have the sources in front of you, even though they're only in English. You know, I apologize, I didn't put them in all the original languages. Because when I get to the sources, I'm going to stop and teach them rather than continue talking. Okay? All right, so let's start. Psalms teaches us, for thee, silence is praise. It'll be a while till we get to the first source. For thee, silence is praise. If I were to listen to this psalm, I would stop right here. Indeed, one of the early rabbinic sages, Shimon ben Rabban Gamliel, a name we should all know, Gamliel, counseled, I quote, "All my days I have grown up among the wise, and I found nothing better for a person than silence." Now, again, that should teach us not to talk too much. It is a pleasure and an honor to present the 2014 Brenigmeyer-Verhan Lecture. I want to explore with you the practices of education in late antique Judaism and Christianity, ranging from strict silence to incessant repetition. Is my English okay? Comes from Chicago, so it's with an Israeli accent. Sometimes accompanied by a tune or a chant, and I'll be talking about song much. But I want to begin with an introduction and then talk about Epicureans. And then we'll get to Jews and Christians. First, for a proper understanding of rabbinic education, rabbinic, I mean the period of 1 to 500 of the Common Era, the first half a millennia. I don't mean rabbis. I mean, what they're called rabbis, but the period is, like we say, church fathers. We're talking about the Judaism of the rabbis. So for a proper understanding of rabbinic education, it's important to emphasize that the Jewish sages insisted on orality. Everything had to be by word of mouth as the exclusive means of transmitting their Torah. That's why it became known as the Oral Torah over the first 500 years of the Common Era. Though Holy Scripture was read liturgically from scrolls, written documents were prohibited in rabbinic study circles. You couldn't bring a text into a rabbinic study circle and say this has validity. It had no standing. Everything was by word of mouth. Now that's hard for us to imagine nowadays. Again, I was privileged, this is an aside, I was privileged to see teachers of mine who really controlled the entire 2,700 folio pages text of the Talmud in their head. It was all there. So that was just a sign that it's possible. So I go back. In educational settings, outside of the context of ritual reading, scripture, the Bible itself, was quoted by heart, not read. Rabbinic law and exegesis was also oral, transmitted from student to teacher. This was so much the case that rabbinic literature reports a custom that when a famous rabbi died, other rabbis would go to his community and try to collect his teachings, lest they be lost forever. Because when a sage passed away, his Torah went with him. It was entirely oral. Well, that's kind of astonishing in our day. I'll get to that at the end of the lecture. I could go on in this way. I'll just skip a bit and go to one more example. Even more astonishing was the prohibition to commit to writing the blessings that made up the daily prayer life of a Jew. It goes as far to say, I apologize that I skip around, yeah. It goes as far as to say, I quote the Tosefta, those who write down blessings are like those who burn Torah. Writing a blessing is like burning, now that's a very striking statement. It's hard to explain, but all I want to use it for now is to say they simply didn't write Torah, literature, anything. The only written document was Bible, and that was committed to memory. And when they taught Bible, except for in the synagogue, when they taught, it was always oral and by heart. We'll see more about that from St. Jerome. So now we can begin. Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai won renown and praise for reconstituting rabbinic Judaism after the destruction of the Second Temple in 70 of the Common Era. Yochanan ben Zakkai. He'll appear second on your handout. We'll get there in a minute. I said reconstituting, and here we're in a major, this is an aside, we're in a major debate. Because two of my predecessors at these prestigious lectures are of the opinion that rabbinic Judaism grew along with Christianity, side by side, interacting with each other, and it's a fairly new kind of Judaism. That's not my thinking. Now, who's correct? I don't know. What is clear is that after the temple was destroyed, there was a need to adapt that Judaism to a centerless Judaism. So the center became the study of Torah, which it had been even prior in some circles. So that's politics, but I'll get back to that. That Yochanan ben Zakkai in 70, one of his premier students in the late first century, Elazar ben Arach, is credited with the following curious adage. I quote the version from the best manuscripts of the Mishnah, as translated by a great scholar from America of many years ago, Judah Golden, who has a great essay called A Philosophical Session in a Tannaitic Academy. Here comes the source itself, and it's number one on your handout. So let's see what we can do with it. Rabbis and Epicureans, says Elazar ben Arach at the close of the first century, and this is only according to manuscripts. If you read the general, it will not read this way. Be diligent to learn how to answer an Epicurean. Know in whose presence you are toiling, and faithful is thy taskmaster. Mishnah, meaning edited around the third century, Avot. Now, know in whose presence you are working and who's paying you. That's God. But what I want to point out is the word laboring and toiling. For them, Torah was acquired through hard work. And we'll get back to that too. But what's this Epicurean business? Why an Epicurean, right? Okay, you know as well as I that in late antiquity there were four or five major schools of philosophic thought in the Greco-Roman world. You had the Stoics, you had the Middle and Neoplatonists, and one of them was the Epicureans. But why, of all the people in the Talmud, I'll go back to the text now, Epicurus is the only ancient philosopher mentioned in rabbinic literature. No Aristotle, no Plato, no, you name it, Plotinus. Only Epicurus. Why? Golden himself thought that to be called an Epicurus, a Hebraized version of Epicurean, had become a popular slur, like calling someone a communist in the USA of the 1950s. If you want to say something bad about him, call an Epicurus. But I think that the rabbis understood both the threat of Epicurus' system of teaching as well as his denial of providence. You remember, everything's automatic, according to Epicurus. There's no providence. But one of the things I think that threatened the rabbis was the way the Epicureans went about teaching their philosophy. And now, I speak a couple of paragraphs about that using Martha Nussbaum's wonderful book, The Therapy of Desire. Memorization was not only a means of education for Epicurean school of philosophy, but was advocated by Epicurus himself 300 years earlier. To facilitate memorization, which Epicurus thought was essential, he prepared epitomes of his book, which were easily memorized summaries of his chief tenets. What was it called? Anybody remember Epicurus's summary? This is open to 5-point bonus. Anybody? No? Curiae doxae or something like that. You know, the chief tenets. In Martha Nussbaum's book, The Therapy of Desire, she claims Epicurus advocated memory and repetition for many reasons. I quote part of her summary. First, according to Nussbaum, memory is the student's way of taking the teaching inside himself or herself, so that it will, and I quote, become powerful, dunamis, and can help her, in the confrontation with error. If a person's got it memorized, when they confront someone else who is in error, they will have something to say. Go back to Elazar ben Arach, who says, know how to respond to the Epicurean, which is tit for tat. Like, they know how to talk, you have to know how to talk to them. If one has to look up writings each time, if you have to go back to the book to check false doctrine, you'll often be caught unprepared. If you know something, you have to have it here and here. It's not enough to have it in the book or know where it's at. Just think of how that compares to our present culture, which is accessing information. Second, says Nussbaum, memory of a compendium provides a comprehensive grasp of the structure of the whole system. And I quote her translation of Epicurus, in silent fashion and as swiftly as thought. Silent, when you have it memorized, you would do it quickly and silently. In terms of our topic, Epicurus highlights the advantage of memorized material. It is silent and swift. A lot of gigabytes. Just making sure you're awake. Okay. So for him, repetition and memorization for Epicurus were a means to achieve silent and swift recollection. Okay. Now, the Jewish predilection for memorization aroused in St. Jerome, according to one leading 19th century scholar, admiration and chagrin. I quote Krauss's collation of St. Jerome's views on Jewish education. You know, a lot of people have worked on Jerome and the Jews. The most recent is a Hebrew University dissertation in 1997 in Hebrew, unfortunately, by Hillel Neumann, one of the great scholars of Jerome and the Jews. He's brought real precision, which I'm going to leave out here, but I'm just going to give you a medley of what Krauss took from Jerome's writings about Jerome and the Jews on education. You with me? Jerome was a neighbor of mine. I live in Talpiot, and he lived 10 minutes away in Bethlehem. So that, you know, I like Jerome. Here we go. I quote this quoting of Jerome, not by language. The Pharisees are reproached by Jerome with always repeating, never reflecting. They spend too much time going back over their Torah and not thinking about it enough. You know, that the tension between scope and breadth and control and analysis is a key tension in education to this day. He goes on, quoting Jerome in translation, "In childhood, the Jews acquired the complete vocabulary of their language and learned to recite all the generations in chronicles from Adam to Zerubbabel with such accuracy and facility as if they were giving their own names." Again, Jerome wasn't one of the great admirers of the Jewish people. So when he admires their educational aspects, you have to take that to heart. Now it comes out more clearly, he quotes, "It gave them pleasure to annoy the Christians by intoning long lists of names." Now, all I need to take from that is the Jews tried to control the Bible, have it in their heads, and take it with them. I'm skipping Hillel Neumann for another time. That's what David told me to do. Now, let's turn to an important source, which is really not used at all, which in the most lapidary fashion, lapidary, it's a good English word, short, brief, emphasizes most of the key elements of Jewish education as conceived by the Jewish sages of the first six centuries. Both this source and another come from that work I called earlier the Tosefta. Tosefta is a mid-third century compilation of oral law, which became a supplement to Mishnah. Now, we're going to do the source together, too, Yochanan's forgetfulness. The topic here is a little far out, but the ideas are important. Here we go. This is that same Yochanan ben Zakkai around 70. I did A, B, and C just to help us. His students asked Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai, "In what attire was the red heifer done?" Remember that red heifer? It comes up in the second surah of the Quran. That's where you should know it from. But it's also in Numbers, right? Numbers 21, 18, 19, somebody will correct me. It's the process by which a person defiled by the highest level impurity, which is contact with a dead body, is made clean, is made pure. It's the ashes of the red heifer. Don't ask me why. So they ask him a particular part of the question of the ceremony. What kind of dress? There are two kinds of dress. There's formal dress. Those are golden clothes of the high priest, is in Exodus. Or they're the simple white clothes. So they ask him that particular ceremony, how was it done? Now, what's interesting about that ceremony was not done in the temple. It was done up on the Mount of Olives. So it was outside the temple precinct, but it was part of the official goings-on. So was it formal temple wear or not? That's the question. He said, in the golden garments of the high priest. They said to him, the students, but you taught us the simple white garments. Which is it? He said to them, ah, you've spoken well. A deed that my hands performed, my eyes observed, but I forgot. And when only my ears heard, how much more so? Meaning, you've got it right, I got it wrong, and even though I witnessed it with my eyes, I forgot. So you should be so careful when you learn from me, because the only sense you're using in learning is? The only sense you're using is hearing. That's how Torah goes down. So you have to be real careful. Now, was this staged? Did Yochanan ben Zakkai stage it? Did he really know and he wanted to test them? We'll see somebody saying that in a minute. So the anonymous voice of the Tosefta says, not that he really forgot, didn't know, but he sought to accelerate, to goad his students, and so on and so forth. So Yochanan ben Zakkai in 70 teaches his students how important it is to try to remember by a test case. I forgot what I witnessed with my eyes and felt with my hands. You who only hear, how much more so you should be careful. Okay? All right. Somebody doesn't like it that he didn't know. But maybe he did, maybe he didn't. He didn't live near me. Now, Rabbi Joshua said, Rabbi Joshua was one of the favorite students of Yochanan. What we're going to have here is three generations of teacher, student, teacher, student. Joshua is Yochanan ben Zakkai's student. He says, he who learns but does not labor, here we go again, is as a man who sows but does not reap. If you think you learned it going over it once, you simply don't have it. And it's just like sowing and letting the grain stay there, not reaping it. Look at the next one, terrible. He who learns Torah and forgets, you can't go look it up in a book. There's no book. It's like a woman who gives birth and buries. Stillbirth. Terrible. Why would anybody use a metaphor like that? Simile. Third generation, Rabbi Akiva. So I've moved from 70 to 100 to 130. Rabbi Akiva says, sing me always sing. Sing me always sing. Look where we've come. From the teacher who dissembles, makes as if he doesn't know the answer in order to get his students to understand how they have to really go over their material, to Rabbi Joshua, who uses the strongest terms to try to say, don't forget and keep going over it. Finally, Rabbi Akiva comes up with this cheery kind of antidote. What's that? Sing me. Now, evidently, it's Torah talking here. Sing me, always sing. That's part of our song. We'll get to it. Okay? Okay. Now, that's the second source. Any questions? Are we okay? Clear? First two are clear? Good. So I've got other things to say, but I've pretty much summarized them. We're going to skip to the middle of page 6. It is Rabbi Yochanan's student, Rabbi Joshua, footnote 5. It is Rabbi Yochanan's student, Rabbi Joshua, who reinforces his teacher's lesson by formulating it as a pithy two-part simile. First, he who learns but does not labor is a man who sows but does not reap. Labor here, I think, is effort and toil one is to invest in fully understanding the material that has been memorized, but I'm not sure. What does it mean to labor in this material? Is it to keep going over to make sure you've got it because it's oral and memorized? Or is it trying to understand once you have it? Is that the labor involved? Again, that tension is throughout rabbinic literature between making sure you have the received tradition in your head, and laboring at it, trying to understand it. Talked about it yesterday, Gemara and Svara, reasoning and received tradition, two ends of the same pole. But the second simile is an ominous warning, recasting his teacher's caution in the worst terms. He who learns Torah and forgets is like a woman who gives birth and buries. Losing Torah by forgetfulness entails the same sense of loss in what I hope is rhetorical hyperbole as the loss of an infant. It's horrible. But when you have a sense of the fragility of the tradition, how easy it is for an oral tradition to evaporate or be changed. Again, this is supposed to surprise you, does it? A little bit, no? Okay. Both of the sages discussed thus far were seminal, important figures in their generation, and both Yochanan ben Zakkai and Yehoshua left an indelible impression on Jewish tradition. But arguably, Rabbi Akiva became the ultimate representative of oral Torah for all coming generations. This is so much the case, Akiva was the key figure, that a famous legend in the Talmud portrays Moses, as unable to understand Akiva. In a flight of enormous literary imagination, the Talmud continues, Moses, after listening to Akiva teach and not understanding him, goes back to God and says, if you've got a guy like this, give him the Torah. Why are you giving it to me? So Akiva is really considered the star of rabbinic Judaism of the first three centuries. Rabbi Akiva then turns to what he considers the remedy to Rabbi Yochanan and Rabbi Joshua's problem. It is what he holds the key to be the key to successful retention of teaching. Now I go into a grammatical, I think I'm going to leave it out for now, and just translate it, because it could be translated otherwise, the words in Hebrew. But I'm going to translate it now, sing me always sing. But what did he mean, Rabbi Akiva? He's generally been understood to me a technique to enhance memorization. Right? If you sing a song, it's a good way to keep it in your head. Sing me always sing. This technique was widespread in schools of rhetoric in Greco-Roman times and elsewhere, harking back much earlier. There is a suggestive, this is an aside, if you want to rest, take a rest. There's a suggestive, though hardly conclusive support to this, in Syriac Christianity's linking of the role of the choir master and the exegete. I don't know whether this works or doesn't, but Adam Becker, in his wonderful book about Syriac Christianity, The Fear of Heaven, talks about the two jobs going together, being the main exegete, the main teacher of Bible, and being also the choir master. Do you have anything to say? No? Okay. But we would be well to note the marked change in the tone of Rabbi Akiva from his teachers. Whereas Yochanan and Joshua had urgent pleas, don't forget, Rabbi Akiva's statement is brimming with confidence and bespeaks a new, more optimistic ambience. There's a better atmosphere. So 60 years after the destruction of the temple, it seems like rabbinic culture has stabilized. And we don't have to give the same dire warnings. Rabbi Akiva's instruction to chant Torah. Now I'm talking about oral Torah. In synagogues, they chanted the biblical scripture. But I'm talking about the oral law. How many times do you go to a ritual bath? How many times do you recite the reading of Shema at night? All those laws Those two were done in a chant. As is well known, Rabbi Akiva valorized, he emphasized love as the heart of Judaism. He accorded the Song of Songs the holiest status in Scripture. He deemed it the holy... Round two. He deemed it the holy of holies of Scripture. Love thy neighbor was for Rabbi Akiva the cardinal rule, klal gadol, and was the focal point of his religious thought. Interestingly, he calls it not, as Jesus did, a commandment, mitzvah or entole, thus diverging from the formulation in the New Testament. It's an overarching principle, not a commandment. I say this as an aside, just to get you thinking. This topic has been written about, and you can look it up. I want to add one more thing to Rabbi Akiva's educational idea, sing me. And that was his protest against people who sang the Song of Songs at weddings. You know, the Song of Songs is a great love song. To this day in Israel, many brides and grooms walk down the aisle to some popularization of verses from the Song of Songs. Rabbi Akiva says the following: one who modulates his voice in the Song of Songs at a wedding party and makes it like a kind of song has no portion in the world to come. Hands off the Songs of Songs. That's only to be sung for one purpose, not for marital bliss. So what we've learned is Rabbi Akiva is encouraging one to chant all of one's learning. The key to keeping learning is singing, but never to sing the Song of Songs. Only in a liturgical context, maybe. Chanting one's learning became so important to Rabbinic Judaism that Rabbi Yochanan Napcha, another Johanan, but 200 years later, the greatest sage of the land of Israel in Talmudic times, built on Akiva's approach and advanced the following bold exegesis of Ezekiel 20:25. We'll try to read it together in number three, studying in song. So this is 100 years after Akiva. The greatest sage of his period, lived in Tiberias, died in 279. Yochanan says the following: and Rabbi Shephatiah said in the name of Rabbi Yochanan, one who reads without a chant. Now, the verbs are important here in the Hebrew. Reads implies reading scripture. Without a chant, and recites, always means Mishnah, the oral law. Without a song, Scripture says about him, I gave them statutes that were not good, and ordinances they can't live by. If you learn, read Torah, or recite oral Torah without song, those are bad laws. Now that's strong stuff. So again, the educational impetus here of the importance of learning along with singing is taken, embraced by the 100 years later, and even further than Rabbi Akiva. He gave this nice, sing me. But Rabbi Yochanan says, if you're not singing, those aren't good laws. Okay, we've got that, right? On we go. As an aside, I'm skipping to the end of that paragraph. I would add that to this day, traditional Talmudic learning is done in a sing-song fashion. If you walk into a yeshiva anywhere, but mostly in Jerusalem or Bnei Brak or New York or somewhere, you'll see an enormous room, sometimes a smaller one, doesn't matter, and an enormous amount of noise. People are studying in pairs and all the time reading aloud and talking to each other. It's amazing because for a yeshiva person to move to a library is not easy. Libraries have the opposite ethos. And I was saying, what's right or wrong? Different. I'll get to Christianity in a minute. Let's look at one, I checked this with a friend, a colleague in the School of Education who's doing research on yeshiva learning, and he says that Talmud is always accompanied by prosody, which is a nice word, but I'm not sure what he meant. Let's look at one final Talmudic source, and that is number 4. It became one of my favorites. I can't say why. I'm reading it with you. Is that to say, you with me, number 4 on the other side? One who does not speak cannot learn? They're talking about challenged learning. If a person is dumb, mute, can he learn or not? This, again, the question seems clear that they envisage learning as repeating and talking. But those two mutes who were in Rebbe's neighborhood, a famous rabbi of the 3rd century, they were the sons, without an apostrophe, of Rabban Yochanan ben Gudgudah's daughter. Well, we've got the whole lineage. They were Yochanan ben Gudgudah's, a different Yochanan, number 3, his grandchildren, who whenever the rabbi would enter the house of study, they would enter and sit in front of him and nod their heads and move their lips. They couldn't talk, but they would move their lips. He prayed for them. That's the Aramaic of asked for mercy. And they were healed. It was found that they had learned the laws, sifra, sifre, they learned it all. They were the exception. A test case that even if a person can't say it out loud, if they're trying to, they were moving their lips. If they were trying to, well, then that is the beginning of learning. But that's just to emphasize again that learning has to be speech, not a speech like this. People talking to one another. Okay. We're getting towards the end. We've got another 10 minutes if you can hold out. Maybe a little more. One thinks by contrast, well, let me go a little, one paragraph first. Learning in the rabbinic world was essentially a speech act. As far as I can tell, every learning situation portrayed in rabbinic literature, every learning situation when they portray people learning together, with only the rarest exception, is always people speaking, talking to one another, even reciting aloud to oneself. The mainstream of the rabbis understood speaking Torah as fulfilling the highest commandment of the Torah. Rabbinic Judaism privileged talking Torah over all else, which is amazing. Now, there were undercurrents, there were different streams, but that became the religious obligation. One thinks, next paragraph, by contrast, of Augustine's famous description of St. Ambrose, Bishop of Milan, reading silently. I won't talk about that because all of you know it. But I do want to talk about one scholar there's a number of articles over the last 30 years about silent reading in antiquity. The idea was most people thought that almost all reading in antiquity was aloud in all the cultures, not just Jewish. But here you have Ambrose reading quietly. So they've come around to try to say that there was silent reading in antiquity, but it wasn't the norm. It wasn't the usual way to do it. So I bring this, one scholar suggested something by St. Cyril of Jerusalem, who says the following. That's number 5 on your handout. And I'm going to, well, let's read it. And again, says Cyril of Jerusalem in his Pro Catechesis. And again, let the young women's group gather in such a way, whether it is praying psalms or reading in silence, their lips move, but the ears of others do not hear, which is recollection of Hannah, in Samuel. And because, for I do not permit a woman to speak in church. And let the married woman do likewise, and let her pray and move her lips. But let no sound be heard, so that Samuel may come, so that your barren soul may give birth to the salvation of God who hears you, for this is what Samuel means. So he brings this, one of these articles, as another more evidence for silent reading. I don't think it's good evidence. I think it's an exceptional case. I think this has to do with the role of women in the church in different places, but I put it out there because he says it. There's another one, number six, from Cicero, much earlier, and we'll look at that one too. Cicero also is dealing with, he's returning to the special case of a challenged person, this time a deaf person. Cicero says, six, and if, maybe, music has charms for them, they should first reflect that many wise men lived happily before music was invented. Secondly, that far greater pleasure can be derived from reading than hearing verse. This is also complicated, and the Latin is beyond me. But basically, he tried to prove in the JBL that here also, they're not listening to the reading, they're reading silently. I don't know. There is then substantial evidence, the bottom page 11, there is then substantial evidence that silent reading was practiced in late antiquity. But in terms of educational practice, it seems quite certain the recitation, chanting, and memorization were the three pillars of ancient Jewish education and occupied a similar position in classical and Christian education. Now I'm going to come to a summary. The rabbinic Jews of late antiquity privileged speech above all else. I'm going to take a minute to talk about that. What does that mean, to privilege speech? I'm off in another world, yeah. Privileged speech means that essentially in one ancient source you have speech, action, and thought. I'm talking about a Jewish source, the Tosefta. And of those three, speech, action, and thought, as strange as it sounds, the one that receives the highest valuation is talk. We Americans always used to say, talk is cheap. But for the rabbis, talk was everything. And I'm going to try to say why. And I say this also, I'll say it more formally in a minute, but I say it also because of, if you think of Plotinus, how Porphyry describes him, well, for Plotinus, thought was everything. So much so that Plotinus, according to Porphyry, could speak to you and at the same time think about something else. Because his thought, his train of thought went on its track, and talking was a secondary. So he certainly didn't like Plotinus writing, because that was an even more physical adaptation. Thought is abstract. Speech is next. And writing is even worse. So what I'm trying to say is that in that world of Greek philosophy, and I'll get to Christians in a minute, speech has a secondary place. And for the Jews, it was the opposite. Now, ask me, what do they think about thought? I'll try to answer in the questions and answer, but I don't have a good answer. Okay. I go back to the text. Written scripture was memorized and oral Torah was learned by heart. It was then recited in study groups, usually by someone with a gifted memory, but not necessarily smart. There were people called Tanaim, there's a different Tanaim, whose job was to memorize. And the less smart they were, the better, because they had less of a chance to change the text. They just recited it. Recitation was done aloud, with melodic intonation, And subsequently, each topic was analyzed and debated. A later passage in the Talmud has Bruria, the one scholarly female character in the Talmud. 2,700 folio pages of Talmud. One woman. They have Bruria excoriating, meaning bad-mouthing, a student for studying quietly. The great female scholar tells the student, if you want to learn, do it out loud, not quietly. We add that she also upbraided at a renowned sage, one of the great scholars, she upbraided him for talking too much. She said, you should be short. You should always teach your student in the shortest possible way. If it's an oral culture, you want it to be straight and to the point. It is fair to say that the sages, here comes the theological import. The Jewish sages considered the words of Torah to be of one piece with the fabric of the written Torah. Oral Torah held the same divine quality that God's own speech had in creation. The world was created by speech. Let it be. That speech, God's speech in the Torah, is considered powerful, creative. An enormous amount of research has been devoted to the word and the logos in rabbinic and Christian thought. It is abundantly clear, though, that Torah speech was and remained for the rabbis a potent, creative force. It wasn't just talking and it wasn't just learning. It was not to be written down, but to be transmitted orally from one scholar to another, to one student, and to the public at large. This culture, rabbinic culture, spurned physical writing and gave pride of place to speech. I emphasize the ephemerality of an oral tradition. Ephemerality, it can, like a wisp, like a cloud, oral tradition could just evaporate. So why would an embattled Judaism of the first centuries choose orality for its vehicle? Doesn't make sense. I find it almost paradoxical that the rabbinic tradition eschewed material means of preserving. They did not write. And here I'm going to get on to the New Testament and the codices and the church fathers' writing as a contrast. Despite the overwhelming sense of despair and concern we heard in Yochanan ben Zakkai over the loss of tradition due to the destruction of the center of Jerusalem, which is documented in a few places, the rabbis opted for a non-material transmission of their culture. That is strange. I find this paradoxical because, if anything, rabbinic culture celebrated and sanctified the concrete and the mundane and the worldly. It was very much oriented to this world. Both rabbinic ritual and legal system addressed the most physical and earthy human situations. I'm contrasting this to Plotinus. Whereas Plotinus, at least according to Porphyry, some of his scholars think it's not true, said Plotinus was ashamed of being in the body. Remember, that's how it begins. And being in body and writing, that was physical. I was saying the rabbis embraced the physical. They had blessings for every physical act a person can do. And you imagine the wildest act, there's a blessing for it. I'm not kidding. So that those same rabbis who were so physically oriented opted out of physical, material means for retaining their culture. I give an example, but we don't need it anymore. It would seem, on the other hand, and here you can correct me, that the early church drew the first elements of its education from Greco-Roman education. A lot of people have written about this. If you take Origen's early career, as opposed to when he made it to Caesarea, He was a teacher of rhetoric. Thus, the striking emphasis on faith and the story of Jesus' life were committed to writing at a very early stage, at least as early as, what's the earliest Christian writing we have? Huh? I imagine, St. Paul, right? Maybe there was earlier ones, I don't know. But those letters are from the 60s. They're writing down the words probably earlier, but even from then on. But what I do want to emphasize is this was followed, along with, I imagine, a strong oral tradition, a voluminous output of writing from philosophical tracts to apologia and to very learned commentaries on scriptures from the second century on. We've got an enormous amount of writing. And I'm contrasting those two cultures now and how they thought education should be done. We know that Christianity used early Greco-Roman patterns of education to train the students up until Julian's time. The early Christian spirituality was captured in writing, not only in the relative, in diverse ways, and in diverse languages, not only in the relatively new and innovative codex form of the New Testament. I don't even go there, but you know that one of the innovations of Christianity was to have the New Testament in a codex, a book form, rather than in traditional scrolls. That's a different lecture. But in all of the early Christian fathers, prodigious writings after that, from the second century and on, you know how much the church fathers wrote. You know, if you take, I was put up in a wonderful place above the Forum, a bed and breakfast above the Forum, you know, not far from here. And you know, as a person who lives in antiquity, I could picture Justin, martyr, here in Rome, and his martyrdom in 150. Justin's close to my heart because he was born in Nablus, and he wrote one of the important dialogues with the Jews. And then I saw Rabbi Akiva and Rabbi Elazar making pilgrimage to talk to the in the second century. There's a sense of a lot going on here in Rome, but what I'm trying to claim is the religions diverged, at least in their educational thrusts. There's an enormous controversy now, which is tilted towards the side of my two predecessors here, who claim that the parting of the ways between Judaism and Christianity happened much later, in the 3rd, 4th, 5th century, than we used to think. Let's say the Bar Kokhba revolt of 130. All I want to say today is, I hope to have more another time, is that the parting of the ways in terms of education is from the beginning, almost from the beginning, at least as we know it, as it's documented. The move to writing, rather than the exclusive orality of the rabbis, is a major break. And that has to be taken into consideration when we talk about, well, was there a parting of the ways between the two religions, or was there not a parting of the ways? Okay, almost there. I talk about Deuteronomy now. Do you want to hear about Deuteronomy? Just a few words about Deuteronomy. You can read this for the Italian, and I'll do it by heart. The idea of reciting and talking starts in Deuteronomy. If you trust biblical critical scholarship, so you're talking about the 7th century before the Common Era. But put that aside. It was the book of Deuteronomy that turned the Jews into a bookish people. You had to write everything. You had to recite it. There's a wonderful book on on the writing and reciting in Deuteronomy. I won't go through all the details. The king had to write his own scripture. You had to repeat parts of scripture morning and night. You write scripture on your doorpost. There was a whole Torah, if you're to believe Deuteronomy, written at the gates of Palestine, of Israel back then. So when the person came in, they saw the Torah written out. So this strong emphasis on education, seeing the words of Torah and speaking them, begins there. But the rabbis took it and went much farther. I wanted to say more about that, but we're going to leave that. Why this prevalence of writing started in Deuteronomy, continued in much of Second Temple Judaism. Qumran, as you know, you can see Qumran in the picture they took of me here. That was taken at Qumran. The Qumran community left us a whole library full of writings from the second and first century before the Common Era. Those were Jews who wrote. The Pharisees, evidently, but certainly the rabbis, stopped writing, did everything orally. That was their education. Was orality a means to maintain secrecy and confidentiality? Why oral? Was it a device to distinguish their words from the words of Scripture? Or was it an educational decision? You know, Plato has a famous myth about how bad writing is for people's memory and how books don't really teach. Were they semi-Platonic in that sense? Did they think that that wasn't the way to go? We don't have a good answer. But just as Deuteronomy had chosen, when Deuteronomy foresees that the Jews are going to go bad, what does it do? What's the insurance policy Deuteronomy takes out? Those future generations go bad and I want them to know it. How am I going to make them know that I foresaw that? What do? I teach them a song. They memorize a song at the end of Deuteronomy. And that's supposed to remind them. So early on, there was this thought that a memorized song can be the best testimony, the best witness. So this culture of orality began way back, but it's the rabbis who took it to its most extreme. We don't have a strong, substantial answer to why. Why they chose this one, let me say some modern things and then I'll close. Judaism changed when the Talmud became a book. In the 16th century, not far from here, it was first printed. The earliest copies of rabbinic literature we have are Geniza fragments from the 8th century, the earliest we found in Egypt where they were preserved. But it looks like for the first 700,000 years, writing has no standing. The whole move will change when manuscripts start being printed, being written, and when printed editions start coming out. So nowadays, everybody studies from a book. But still, there's an attempt to memorize, but not much. What I want to say is the following. This has to have implications for our modern culture. For Christians, Jews, Islam, whoever you wish, and secularists. What's the right way to go? Are books the way to go? Are iPads the way to go? Is accessing information the way to go? Or is it having it in your heart, carrying it with you? That will secure your identity, as Epicurus would have it. I had a formal ending, and this is what it was. They don't have it. There's a beautiful phrase in the Midrash, and with this I end, that says, Da'at kanita ma chasarta, da'at chasarta ma kanita. If you've bought, acquired wisdom, what are you lacking? If you haven't, What do you have? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Hirschman, for this lecture filled with stimulating and provocative affirmations. In my mind, I was constantly comparing notes with present-day educational models, systems. You said some of it at the end, and I'm sure I was not alone here in this room trying to make those connections. We have time for questions. I would say 10 minutes. There will be a microphone going around, so anyone who would like to engage in a dialogue with Professor Hirschman is most welcome.
You can do a 10-minute question.
No, it will be two 30-second questions. One is, how do you put Shimon Ben Gamliel into this, who learned nothing better than silence? And secondly, unfortunately, I don't know the details about that inscription, but I remember an inscription with a fairly long and identifiable Talmudic passage found fairly recently.
Yeah. So recently, yeah. Oh, I'll answer that. Okay. Let's start with the last. I think you're speaking about, which is an amazing find, it's almost Byzantine, it's 5th, 6th century, mosaic in a synagogue, which has about 20 lines, maybe a little less, of the Jerusalem Talmud. And it's the laws of tithing and the borders for tithing. So the question is a good question. You know, it's rare that we have, you know, that's a rare find. Maybe there was more of that, but it's quite clear that was an instruction, meaning that this was supposed to be, it seems to me, supposed to be practical law for those who needed it. But it certainly is exceptional and needs to be taken into account, and it flies in the face of what I was saying. I agree with you. But I can plug a wonderful book. There is a terrific book. I've never in my academic career seen a book receive such high praise from the best in the field. A book by Rina Talgam came out in July, The Mosaics of Faith, it's called. All the mosaics in Israel from the three religions, analyzed in 500 pages with beautiful reproductions, an extraordinary work. So go check what she has to say. She's the authority. So that's the first. You're right. About Rabbi Gamliel, I think in general what he's saying is he's growing among the wise. What you did among the wise was listen. I think that's his point. And even though the formulation there is not simple, I translated it, but lo matzati laguf tov ela shtika, okay? I haven't found for the body, which is strange, or for myself. It can go a lot of different ways. But I think that's what, when you're around wise people, try to listen and don't talk so much. On the other hand, as Philip reminded me yesterday, the bashful person does not learn, the rabbis say. So that's a bit of an answer.
Thank you. I just wanted to make a point. Jesus never wrote anything. The only thing he wrote was on the floor, we don't know what he wrote, and it disappeared. And this is incredibly important from a theological viewpoint in Christianity, because even if there is scripture, we make a distinction between scripture and the Word of God. Scripture becomes the Word of God only when it is interpreted preached in certain contexts, which means that in the end, orality is still the fundamental way through which, let's say, education is made. And so my point would be that the reason for orality in this context seems to be the priority of interpretation over just literalism, which can be an instrument, as we know very well, of ideology and so on and so forth. I don't know if you have any comment related to your paper, to these things.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I won't, in terms of Christian theology, I'm not going to go there. I do some of the church fathers, the Greek church fathers. I did have a senior seminar with Henry Chadwick and Christopher Steed. So I know what I don't know. So I won't talk about that. I still do believe, forget about theology now, I do think that educationally it's quite clear that Christianity used Greco-Roman texts to begin their first processes of education. This is Maru and a lot of others. So that there's a different move going on, and it's different languages also. You'll have to decide, I don't know enough, whether how much of that was oral and how much of it was written. But the fact that when Origen preaches, he's got all these stenographers taking down every word, something's going on. The fact that he builds this enormous library in Caesarea, Pamphilus and Eusebius and all those are continuing. There's a story there. It's not what went on in rabbinic Judaism at the same time. That was my main point. There's a big difference in education. I mean, I think so. And again, without right or wrong, there are different paths. So it's, there was a second part, but now I forgot the second part. I don't remember the second part here.
The reason for orality.
Ah, yeah. Qumran is written, and there's a lot of exegesis going on there. So you're right, it's easier when it's oral, it's more fluid. On the other hand, even to this day, one of the rabbis, when another one gave an exegesis, said to him, Eliezer, I don't remember which one was now, he says, it's as if you tell Scripture to be quiet and let me preach. So that you're right, there's more of a freedom there. But, any text, especially now in a postmodern world, unfortunately, the claim to be able to understand what the text really means has become very problematic, to my chagrin. You're in charge. Yeah.
If it's in translation.
You'll tell me.
Yes, I would like just to comment. Perhaps St. Paul, in his letter, First Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 5, he also said that the gospel is diffused, can only be diffused, not only by the word, but also there are other two criteria, which are the power of the Holy Spirit and the conviction of the person. So
yeah.
In that sense, the oral part is essential.
Keep going. Yeah, no, I appreciate it. I tried to say, the trouble is we don't have much of a history of the oral transmission in terms of Christianity. Or maybe we do and I'm not aware of it. It's hard to document. So I agree with, I'm sure, and I said it in a few words though, that there's clearly an oral tradition that accompanies all the writing. Still, the thrust of writing. Now maybe it was in defense or towards the Greco-Roman world that it was produced. But internally, Jewishly, I'm not even sure it would have had any standing. You're hungry.
Many thanks for the lecture. I like to say that the Shema Israel opens with orality, Shema. And ends with written culture, Uchtaftam al mezuzot betecha, and you write them, these words, on your doors. So both systems belong to at least to biblical Judaism, and Moses is portrayed as a writer, Vayichtov Moshe, and whereas Jesus, as we have heard, is never portrayed as a writer. So my question is that is this stress on orality linked to a stage in Jewish history, and you can reclaim written culture as yours, and the theme of the rewritten Bible is now very productive in biblical studies, the act of rewriting the Bible. So both systems, I would think, belong to your heritage.
Yeah, no, I agree. That's, I said as much in one of the paragraphs, but there's this book by Sonnet, S-O-N-N-E-T, which... sorry. Sorry, I won't go any farther. So you know what I have to say. Yeah, I agree with you. I like that book very much, and it was, you know. And so, you know, I agree with you. Both are there, and I tried to say as much. And what the rabbis, Qumran goes on the writing side, whereas the rabbis went on the oral side. There are precedents, but it was certainly Deuteronomy that changed the world. And even the root, the Hebrew root of lamad, to learn, first appears in the five biblical books of Moses in Deuteronomy. So it became the educational, you know, thrust. And your book is good. It reminds me, I'll end with a joke, like you begin with a joke. But it's a real one, though. I was on an editorial board, and we were doing 150 years of studies of the land of Israel or something. And people, great scholars, gave their contributions, summarizing the field in their particular. One was a political scientist. And we sent them out afterwards for readers to see whether they're good or not, even though these were the best. So one wrote back, the political scientist article is very good, but he didn't quote Uri Bialer enough. He was one who had written the article. So, you know, so some people, you know, you don't have to answer.
It is my pleasure at this point to announce the transition from the academic part of our gathering tonight to the social part, the convivial part. So please don't go home right away. There are refreshments served outside. Please look for the table with kosher food. Thank you very much, Professor Hirschman, for your lecture. And especially thanks to all of you for being here tonight with us. I'm looking forward to seeing you soon again here with an event of the Cardinal Bear Center. Thank you very much.